Stories are massive on Instagram, you know, and they are just such a powerful tool. They're so raw, so authentic.
Hello everyone, welcome to the 18th episode of our podcast Purpose Spotlight. My name is Pawan Rochwani, and in this week's episode, we're going to talk to a creator who has probably tried and started more than 50 or 100 side projects and then eventually find out what her true calling or what she's really passionate about. Not only that, we'll also talk about how to really find your niche and what's the difference between somebody who creates content in just one particular category as a specialist or somebody who's more like a generalist. In this week's episode, we talk to Saloni Srivastav. If you must have seen her content on YouTube or on Instagram, or if you know about Hustle Post Academy, you must have known her. Or if you don't know her, please visit the link in the description of this episode to find out what content she creates about and what she really talks about. And I really, really enjoyed this conversation with her because I could resonate how she, as a creator, is not only trying to just do one particular thing at a time, but putting up videos about cooking, about personal finance, about self-help, literally everything. Let's get into this conversation. This conversation with Saloni was pre-recorded over a Zoom call, which you're going to listen from here on. Thank you so much, Saloni, for giving us your time once again after that very glitchy IG live session that we did probably a few weeks back. But this is going to be like a more structured conversation and some really interesting points that we had discussed on the Instagram live. I want to, you know, just jump back onto those. But even before we start, like, just want to thank you for giving us your time today.
Love that. Thank you so much for having me. I absolutely loved our conversation on the live. Happy to have a non-glitchy version of that here.
You know, I think I missed out on asking you in that Instagram live session one very important question, because a lot of people talk about side hustle, passion project, side project, and, you know, all of these terms. And I mean, as an individual, I understand this is like a hobby project or something. Oh, hobby project was also the term which was like
right
way back. But I think now is like side hustle is become the term for it. How do you define what side hustle really means and what can be identified as a side hustle or not? Because, for example, I also do another podcast show on the side.
And right.
I also write a newsletter or maybe right. teach on the side or whatever, all of those things. So what exactly. is really the definition of a side hustle?
Right. So the way I look at side hustle is, it's very simple. Anything that you do, so, you know, as humans, we are usual, most of us, you know, whether you're a student or a homemaker or a working professional or a freelancer, there's always something that takes up most of your time in the day. You know, that it could be your job, it could be your studies, it could be taking care of your family, no matter what you do, right? So you, apart from the usual activities that you need to do, that which you do as a part of your just, you know, everyday existence, anything that you do on the side just to make yourself happy, I feel like that is how I see side hustle. Now, the only distinction that, you know, I personally believe in terms of the definition of side hustle is the fact that I don't necessarily see side hustle as a money making opportunity. If it makes money, that's great. And if it can generate another source of income, that's amazing too. But it need not be the only agenda behind having a side hustle, right? If you really enjoy something and you're doing that just to, you know, maybe have good conversations with people, maybe to meet the right kind of people, maybe just to feel happy, I feel like that in itself is also a side hustle. That's my opinion.
Yeah, because I think a lot of people try to burden their side hustle or exactly. their side project with, okay, no, if I'm investing 5 hours of my time, then I have to make at least X amount of money out of
right.
it.
Right.
And I think right. that has kind of, you know, blurred the definition and, you know, the whole idea of it for a lot of people on the internet.
Correct. Absolutely.
But, you know, one thing that I personally struggle with, because, you know, I feel like I have 24 hours only and I feel like, oh my God, I already have so much of work. Should I start something new? And, you know, I really have some interesting ideas that I want to pursue in terms of, let's say, writing, podcasting, or whatever, something else. And I'm very sure right. people who are listening to this or watching this, they might also have, let's say, a full-time job, but on the side, they want to do painting right. or guitar,
right.
anything else, or maybe YouTubing also. How do you really find that motivation to start something as a side hustle? Because already, it's so overwhelming outside as well because of this pandemic, and some people have, let's say, full-time jobs. How do you really find that
Absolutely.
motivation?
No, that's such a good question, you know, because, I always go back and I look at my side hustle days, you know, when YouTubing was just something I was doing on the side of like a very hectic full-time marketing job. I look back and I'm very surprised, you know, where was I getting all that motivation? Because, you know, my work would start at 9 in the morning and then it would end at 8 in the night. And then I would have like 2 hours of Bangalore traffic to deal with before I could reach home. So it was essentially like a 8 a.m. to 10 a.m. kind, 10 p.m. kind of a job that I had. And usme bhi I was able to find time to, you know, create 2 YouTube videos a week and really do all of that. I feel like, when I look back, I'm like, where was I finding all that motivation? Because if it was me today, probably I wouldn't have done it. So how did I do that? And my answer, you know, usually is just about, you know, really finding joy in the process itself. You know, there are two types of goals, right? There's the result goal and then the process goal. I honestly feel as long as the process itself is enjoyable for me, I'm able to hit all my milestones there. That then doesn't feel like work to me. So, you know, creating videos back when I started, even though it was very tiring, it was taxing and it took a lot of effort, time, energy, sometimes money as well. But, it was so much fun to do that I was like, no, I want to do this. I would rather, you know, a lot of times I would be invited to like a party, you know, I was newly married, we could have like done like 20 other things, and we could have gone out to like, you know, for vacations, trips, whatever. But I was like, no, I really found joy in creating videos. And because it was such a happy process for me, it made me happy. I was happy to let go of a lot of other things that, you know, I could have engaged in. Feel like it's really just finding something that you truly enjoy, right? And I feel like that's a very difficult thing on its own as well. You know, a lot of people don't really know what they truly enjoy. So to that, I honestly feel just like go out and, you know, if there's something that, you know, strikes you in the head, if there's an idea that comes, go ahead and execute it. It doesn't mean you'll understand, right? Within 10 days, you'll know if you're liking it. Do you want to do it long term? Do you want to stop doing it? And I'm completely okay with leaving projects half baked if I lose interest in that. But at least the excitement of starting something new, actually taking action towards it and seeing if it's making me happy, I feel like that usually is the process that helps a lot.
Yeah. To ask you a small sub question, how many side projects have you like close down, or you know, you like feel that, or you know, you like stop doing it after 10 days?
Oh my god, so many. I've lost count. I at one point I was trying to build a sort of like a Zomato or like a Practo for play schools in my area at one point, and I wasn't, you know, I didn't even have a kid, you know, I don't know why I was excited by that idea. So that I stopped doing. At one point I was trying to start a t-shirt company. I started a career, a free, career coaching sort of a center. I tried doing that for a while. I even went to a lot of schools that I did not close down in 10 days. That probably took 10 months, but then I realized this is not for me. So I stopped that. So I have like probably 50 at least.
So tell me one thing, do you take, let's say, do you take these, I wouldn't term these as, let's say, failures, but do you sort of term this as, you know, keep doing more and more such kind of side projects and side hustles, and then you really find out what you are actually like most passionate about.
Right.
Because I'm assuming while you were doing all of these multiple things, you were still YouTubing, creating videos, right?
Yes.
So that's one thing that, you know, stayed constant. I think very similar for me also. I have tried and done a lot of different projects, but, you know, sometimes they did not even see light, or, you know, even I never promoted it about it on IG stories or anything like that. Sometimes it was just here, started it, did it for 2-3 days. And, you know, like, I was like, no, this is not going online. But in that whole process, it sort of, you know, gave me understanding about myself that, you know, I don't want to do this. So maybe, you know, this is something that I want to keep doing. Was it the same for you, or how was it?
Oh, 100%. And also it was, you know, apart from also realizing what I did not want to do, every process taught me something, in the sense that, you know, for example, I'll take the example of, the career coaching center that I was looking to start for, you know, the underprivileged kids. And I was just trying to do that as a not-for-profit, non-governmental organization. That kind of a setup is what I was trying. And I tried to approach a lot of schools. And, you know, a lot of schools were like, we're not interested. You know, what we need to show our parents is that our kids are making it to IIT and that's what we care about. So I don't want you to come and tell my students that you can be a YouTuber. That's not what we want to promote. So, you know, so it gave me a lot of insight as well, you know, and today when I started something else, so when I'm working with my academy right now, all of those insights, all of those conversations that I had then are now helping me in, you know, building my products a lot better. So apart from also realizing, no, this is not what I want to do, it also gave me a lot of insight, you know, even like building, for example, my t-shirt company, I just was able to understand the whole end-to-end manufacturing process, was able to understand how e-commerce works, you know, pricing and building my own e-commerce store. Felt like all of that was exciting to me, like as a person. I feel like these are now things that I'm able to then expand. And, you know, most of the skills that we learn in processes are transferable. So you move on to a different side hustle, the skills then also transfer anyway.
Yeah, yeah. And I think a lot of these skills are very practical also, right? I mean,
absolutely.
When you keep doing it is when you get better at it. So even if your side hustle has sort of, you know, bumped, but you still have practiced all that skill of how to, you know, absolutely, take a product, market it, how to maybe run ads about it, how to create a website. Maybe you can use those practical skills later for when you really figure out what you want to do.
Exactly.
You know, I really sort of this is somewhere in 2011-12 when a lot of people told me that, you know, you should start YouTubing, and I was like, hey, I don't want to YouTube because I at that point of time I didn't feel like, you know, it's going to scale up, boom up and this much so much, and that's like one big regret I have in life, that I did not start YouTubing in 2011-12 when, you know, my parents and in my house there were like full for a setup and all of those things. How was it for you in the early days when you were creating YouTube? Because, you know, as of now, what I understand as an audience, or let's say somebody who's into this whole content space, I feel like, you know, when you start YouTubing, it's a little slow in the beginning. But once you grow and, you know, you come to, let's say, 10K, 100K or something of that kind of subscribers, you are getting that organic discovery yourself. When you keep doing and create videos in a particular category, then automatically people will discover, maybe remember that name. And then somewhere YouTube recommendation algorithm sort of also helps. But I want to understand from you, because you have been and scaled that up, how really is that journey of a YouTube?
Right. So when I started, so I also wanted to start a YouTube channel back in 2011. But like I told you during our Instagram session also, I just didn't know how. I was like, I want to be in the video. And it was a really simple answer. Tripod was the answer, but I just couldn't arrive there. You know, I just didn't know enough. So I was like, who's going to shoot me? Like, who can I hand over my camera to? And I would call that an excuse now, because honestly, I could have just Googled and I could have figured a way around this, but I was like, no, because I don't have somebody to shoot for me, I'm not going to start right now. And that with that excuse, I procrastinated for 2-3 years. And then 2016 is finally when I, you know, when I decided to take this up seriously and I started. And that 2017 was when I got married. So I was like, okay, now I have my husband, he's going to be the camera person for me. So I handed him over my iPhone and he started shooting all of my videos from there. But for me, you know, even 2017 to now, I feel like it's been a couple of years now, but a lot has changed. You know, back when I started, I feel like while the journey was still very slow, you know, for the first almost a year and a half, I did not make any money off YouTube. Like I wasn't making anything, you know, or even if I was making some money, maybe around the 6 month mark, it was about 2000 rupees a month, which basically counts as no money. So I wasn't really making anything from YouTube. So it is definitely a very, very slow start. And even when you grow right on YouTube, I feel like even today when I have 3.5 lakh followers and all of that, you know, when I upload videos consistently and I do get consistent views, all of that. But even then, it's not like the ad revenue is ever going to be, it's not going to make you like a super rich person, right? So that's not the intention with which I usually recommend people to start a YouTube channel, because honestly, from a money perspective, like from a strictly ad sense perspective, the kind of money you make, it's never going to be a lot. But in the early days when I was starting out, I think it was difficult because, you know, like I said, I had a full-time job, which was more than a full-time job. It was very hectic. And then, you know, I also knew, like, because I was in digital marketing, I was a growth hacker with the organization that I was working with. So I kind of had like a basic sense of social media and digital platforms and all of that. So my approach to YouTube was always a little bit more scientific than like any other, compared to any other beginner. So, you know, I understood SEO very well. I understood optimization. I understood content strategy. Like my approach that way was better. So with the knowledge that I had, my growth wasn't, I wouldn't call it a very slow growth, because within a year I was able to get to like 30,000 subscribers, you know, that kind of mark, which today with the kind of competition that now exists on YouTube, I feel like is not very easy to achieve. But back then it wasn't, it was actually relatively easier to get to like a 30, 50, 100,000 mark within like a year. So that was my journey to begin with. But over time, you know, I started realizing, you know, for most YouTubers, the big money anyway comes through brands, right? Brands are the ones who come and like pay you for your collaborations and all of that. I was always very strategic. I was like, I'm not going to take it up, because my approach to YouTubing from day one was, I'm going to turn this into a business. I'm not looking at YouTube itself to be a source of revenue for me, but the community I build out from this channel, how can I monetize that? So with that approach, I feel like my journey was a little different from most YouTubers, because, you know, most YouTubers, when they start out, their focus is grow, 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 brand, and then ad revenue, and then, you know, increase consistency. For me, it was more focused on, you know, strategic content, getting the right brand partners. And so that was my focus to begin with.
Got it. I have two questions about it. One is related to building a personal brand, and the second one is related about how you eventually end up creating Hustle Post Academy. So let's start with, how did the inception of the idea of building an academy and building a course you know, took that place in this whole such a roller coaster journey of so many side hustles and then full-time job and YouTubing? So tell us about how did that idea inception happen and how did it really start?
So for me, I actually have a teaching background as well. So I had a side hustle even as a kid. I used to take tuitions for, you know, kids in my society. I was always good at mathematics. I was like, I'm going to teach maths to people. And I was the mathematics didi in my society. Every kid who was weak in math, like their mother would come and beta isko padha do. I was always that person. So teaching was always very, very close to me. I always wanted to do that. Right after college, before I took like a year off before I could go for my master's, and I was like, I'm going to take this year to explore. And in that year, I started teaching in a college. So I was appointed as an ad hoc lecturer. I was teaching there. So I've had a really good, you know, sort of teaching specific journey also. Like I have a lot of experience there. So when I started my YouTube channel, I was always like, you know, if I crack this, I'm going to teach people this, because, you know, there wasn't anybody. When I wanted to start my YouTube channel, I was looking for one big YouTuber to, you know, have like an academy of sorts where they could teach people, how do you do this? How do you crack this game? And there wasn't any, nobody was doing that, you know, back in 2017. So it's like, if I crack this, I'm going to be the one to launch this course. So that was always something that I had in the back of my mind. But then as I grew and, you know, because there were too many things I was doing, this idea just got buried somewhere. You know, it just got buried. I like five or six times in the last couple of years, I had, you know, started the planning process of launching an academy to help people become YouTubers and all of that. But I would shoot two videos, two classes, and then I would back off. No, this is not perfect. I'm going to stop it. Whatever. But then it was 2020, just the beginning of the pandemic. I had about four international collaborations lined up, big money, $2,000-$3,000 each kind of collaborations, and for each month. And they were like 6-7 month long, contracts that I had. So just the lockdown was announced in India and internationally everywhere. And about 20th of March, and I went off to sleep. Next morning, I woke up in my inbox. I got emails from all four brands saying, we're canceling this. We're calling this off for now, because we're not sure where this is going. We don't know if you want to do this. And so that really like shook me up. I was like, okay, so I don't have any, you know, I wasn't seeing any consistent income coming for the next couple of days. And then, of course, even the YouTube ad revenue fell. Everything fell. So I was just like at a point where I was like, okay, so now I do have time to think, because, you know, when you're working with brands, when you have all of these things, that takes up all of your time. So apart from the fact that, you know, of course, a lot of money stopped coming in, the other idea was that I suddenly got a lot of time. So oddly, I was happy also that, you know, now I have time. Let me go back to my ideas book. Let me look at, you know, the things I always had in the pipeline. And what can I use this time? How can I use this time productively to launch something? And then, I also started hearing all these really sad news of people, you know, getting salary cuts and people losing their jobs. And I was like, I need to do something, because by that time, like, I had 3 lakh subscribers. I was making a decent income. I'd built a team. I had launched a plan. So I also have side hustles right now. So I have a planner business on the side. I sell planners. And then, you know, I also have an e-commerce platform for other influencers to sell their products. So it's like, I figured this space out for sure. Can I teach this to people? Can people use this time to also launch their own businesses, to start their own online businesses, side hustles? Can I help them do that? So it's like, that's it. You know, all this while I was like, I want to launch a YouTube course. And the reason why I wasn't able to get myself to do that was because I never wanted to be a YouTube teacher. Because, you know, for me also, I was never, like I told you, my approach was to YouTubing was never YouTubing itself. It was using YouTube as a means to really build other businesses. So I was like, now this makes a lot of sense. Let me use this time to create an academy where I teach people, you know, how to start a side hustle, an online side hustle, powered by their personal brands, you know, starting with content creation and then slowly turning that into, you know, any kind of a side hustle or a business or a freelance business or whatever. And I was like, this is it. This is golden. And then in 2 weeks, I was able to just create the whole academy and launch it.
Wow. Even when you were talking about it, I could really, you know, feel and visualize it in my head that, oh, this is how it all happened. This is what the story is and all of it. But super, I think when you launched it on the first day itself, some 600 or...
Oh, yes. Yeah.
...signed up for it. And I think that number itself tells that, you know, how maybe people were interested into this. And this course and the academy really hit the right nail at that point of time.
Correct. Absolutely.
To ask you something about, you know, personal branding, I feel, you know, when you are building a personal brand on the internet, as of now in this year, or let's say in the past few years, you really have to put yourself out there. It's really about what you're doing every day. What are the thoughts that are going on in your head about, let's say, a particular situation out there, or in general about how your Wednesday is going, how your Thursday is going, and all of those sort of things. How do you manage that? Because personally, I feel, you know, whenever I'm trying to be a little open about my thoughts, I feel like, oh, should I put this up or should I not put this up?
Makes sense.
If it's, let's say, about something about the industry itself, if I want to talk something very opinionated about the content ecosystem, I sometimes think about, should I really do that or I shouldn't? How do you manage being yourself on the internet?
So that was something that, you know, it a lot of people, when I started out with my YouTubing journey, a couple of years before that, I was a massive YouTube consumer. So I'm the kind of person who knows about every YouTuber. I would consume all their contents, know about all their journey, like how their journey was and all of that. So massive consumer of YouTube. So one thing that I saw massively lacking on the YouTube space back then, right? Back in 2016, 2015, that's the time I'm talking about. And most YouTubers had a very polished presence on YouTube. Everyone was very, you know, the best version of themselves. That was the vibe back then. You know, everyone would have like perfectly laid out breakfast tables with like, you know, all kinds of things. And, you know, that was the kind of vibe that really clicked with people back then. I could sort of never relate to it because, you know, my life was subha utho, maximum have like maybe a glass of milk and then go to office, because that's all I could afford, like maybe chocos. That's all I could afford in the kind of time I had. So, you know, I was like, why isn't anybody, you know, showing this? Like, why are people having these beautifully laid out breakfasts and stuff in the morning? How are people vlogging that? So I was like, okay, let me just, you know, try to bring in a more authentic picture. And there were a couple of YouTubers who were doing that. For example, mostly Sane Prajakta always has been, she's known for being very raw and very authentic and very herself. So, you know, the kind of creators who were doing that, I was able to relate to them a lot more. So it's like, should I bring that, you know, that onto the table? Because I started off as a lifestyle YouTuber, and I feel lifestyle as a space was very cluttered. It had, and by lifestyle, most people just assume lifestyle as, you know, makeup, fashion, you know, that was primarily it. So I was like, okay, like, I'm just going to not put on lipstick and come on camera. I'm just going to be like how I am and, you know, just show myself. So authenticity was definitely something that I was very particular about, you know, about the kind of brand that I wanted to have. And like I told you, I have a marketing and growth hacking that background. So even branding was something that I knew, like just the theory behind it, the science behind it. So it's like, you know, I knew my brand archetype. I was like, okay, I'm not going for an aspirational brand. I'm going for a very, you know, relatable every man, that kind of a brand. So I had those ideas in my head. And so I would the personality that, you know, I've been able to project wasn't very, it was carefully designed in the sense that it's me, but it's also carefully designed me that, you know, I want to come across as somebody who's very relatable. So that's something that I did. And in terms of, you know, having filters to thoughts and stuff, I feel like I'm very open to just talking about anything on social media. I really don't have a filter, you know. Of course, there are things that I don't talk about, which I feel like I don't have enough knowledge to have an opinion on. Like I may have an opinion myself, but I don't come and, you know, talk about something. For example, the issue that's been happening right now, I don't come and I talk about it unless I know about it really well. But about anything that's me, my you know, the space that I'm in, my career, you know, anything that I know about, I'm very confident and I come and talk on camera. Does that mean I get a little bit of flack here and there? Yes, I do. But I feel like I'm okay with that. So it's more about just, I feel like what works on social media then versus now. Now people are not really excited about seeing a very, you know, polished image of somebody or a very, you know, picture perfect photos and all. I think that was very 2015 Instagram. 2021 Instagram is more raw, very you, very real, you know. Yeah, that's the vibe that I you know, strongly believe is what works today.
Got it. And one more small sub question with respect to personal branding itself. You, in your course and in a lot of your videos also, you help people to figure out what their niche is and, yes, you know, how they can pick up a category or let's say one segment of the full content space. Like, what, how do you really figure that out? How do you really teach someone to really, you know, let's say for somebody who has multiple interests, or, you know, let's say they're good at multiple things. How do you really tell someone to, you know, this is how you go ahead and find your niche? Because this is like the tip, or let's say the suggestion that the whole internet gives to creators, that, you know, find your niche, build that niche and all of
those. Absolutely.
Things. What is that process of identifying somebody's niche?
Yeah, so I have a 4-step process that I talk about in my academy. A lot of it really, you know, so a couple of things that I ask people to consider, you know, A, of course, is, you know, what you already consume. Because I feel like, you know, the stuff that you already consume says a lot about the kind of things you're interested in. And, you know, a lot of people may not be able to answer what you like, but what you consume, they can just go back, have a look at their search history, and they'll get a sense of, you know, what is it that they usually consume. And, you know, and I ask them to go back a little bit, you know, and find patterns, things that are very common, people who they really follow, people who they very strongly connect with. So that's definitely a pillar that I ask people to consider. I also ask people to consider, you know, their interests in general. So, you know, I ask them questions like, so there are, of course, there's a full activity, but one of the questions that they're asked to answer is, if you can just sit and talk to somebody for hours about something, what is that thing? Like, what are some of the things that you can just like casually have a conversation about anytime? And a lot of people are like, I can talk about TVs, maybe I can talk about TV shows, movies, web series, whatever. Like, you know, it could be cricket, it could be whatever. So, you know, that gives them a little bit of perspective. Then I also ask them to, you know, think about, you know, interest in another way, which is, if you were to do something for free, even if somebody didn't pay you and you were to like sort of do it, what is that? You know, even if nobody pays you to do that, what's something that you'll happily do for free? And this, again, helps people arrive at this answer a lot. So this is another pillar that we talk about. And the last pillar we also talk about is, you know, your already existing base of knowledge that you have. So stuff that, you know, you already know. So what have you studied? What are you good at? What are some things that people usually come to you for advice? And, you know, stuff like that. So there are like all of these pillars and questions that I ask, and then of course, you know, they have to do a little bit of pattern finding activity. I have a list of, you know, side hustles according to categories, and then that's how they choose it. I feel like it's really just these three pillars, you know, what you consume, what you like and are interested in, and what are you good at. As long as you find like a sort of a meeting grounds of the three, that can solve the problem for most people. But you know what, the bigger question here is, Like, you know, you are not the same person, I'm sure, that you were a couple of years back. So yeah. I don't want people to also be super rigid on that. You know, maybe you start out as a content creator today. Tomorrow you can move on to maybe, you know, doing, I don't know, website designs. It could be anything, you know, whatever you learn along the way. Keep yourself a little bit more open. And that's, I believe is the biggest benefit of having a personal brand. Because a personal brand is not a company. It's not a non-living thing. It's a living thing. So it evolves and it grows. Yeah. So your brand also sort of evolves with you. So I started off, you know, back in the day when I started my YouTube channel, I was newly married. So a lot of my content was around, you know, how I'm setting up my kitchen, how I'm setting up my home, because I was super excited about that. The same channel today has grown from that to side hustles, to finance, to I don't know what all. So, you know, people have seen that journey. They relate with that journey. They've grown with me. And because I'm a human, I'm allowed to talk about that and also talk about finance and also talk about productivity and anything else that I want.
Yeah.
So, you know, find your niche, start taking action, move on. If you don't like it, move on in a couple of years. If you think this is not me anymore, move on from there. I think it's actually just that.
Yeah. But what do you say to people, you know, because you have multiple kinds of videos on your channel. There are a lot of people who keep saying on the internet that, as an advice, let's say whatever content leaders and all of those people, that you know, stick to one category, don't you know, be everywhere. So, and they also say that, you know, you should only post one type of videos or one kind of content, whatever, all of those things. What do you have to say about that? While has it affected you because you create multiple different kinds and categories of videos, or has it helped for you?
Yeah, so see, I think there isn't a right or a wrong answer here. I truly believe that, you know, micro niching and knowing exactly what you're super specific about is great, you know. So it's again the specialist generalist debate, you know. And a lot of people, you know, look at specialists as, oh, that's amazing, and generalist is not good to have. But I am actually of the opinion that, you know, I have always been a generalist in my life. I can do like 100 things pretty well. I'm not the best person to do anything in the world, but I can do like 100 things pretty well. And I feel like, you know, this idea that you have to micro niche is a very specialist theory, that, you know, a lot of people will be able to do that. But there's a huge category of people, because there's this concept, a lot of people give this particular advice to people that you have to micro niche is what stops them. You know, we don't have more creators today because they're like, I don't know what to create with. Start whatever you want to. You know, if you want to talk about 10 different things on your channel, talk about 10 different things on your channel. I feel like generalists and specialists have their own place in this world. You know, both can survive, and both of them are needed in the market. So while, you know, salon and my personal brand today is, for me, it hasn't really affected so much. I don't know. I've not seen the other side. Had I been a finance only creator, would that have helped me? Maybe it would have, right? I'm sure it would have helped me. But today, I feel more excited about the fact that I can talk about multiple things. You know, today I don't have to then, you know, think about, oh, but like what else to talk in finance, or what else can I create? I never have to think about that. If today I discover a really nice recipe of Maggi, I'm going to show that. If you know, oh, I invested in Dogecoin, I'm going to talk about that. I'll talk about whatever, you know, excites me. So I feel like that is a more, for a person like me, for people who tend to be multi-passionate, who have multiple interest areas, you know, I want this to be known in the world that it's okay if you don't micro niche, if you don't niche down. It's okay to, like, you know, try different things, and, you know, you will build your own brand around that. So for me today, my brand is Saloni talks about a lot of things. You know, people don't really have like a box that they put in, but I see that as a positive.
Got it. And how does it go technically? Like, for example, because, you know, you'll be creating multiple kinds of videos, and the kind of tags, or let's say hashtags, that you'll be used will be different, right? If you have to talk with respect to, let's say, Instagram. So Instagram page usually, like, suggested that, you know, use particular hashtags only which are to your category. If you use multiple categories, then your content algorithm might just, you know, algorithm ke bahut sare nuske and tips wagere. How does it work technically, creating multiple kinds of content?
See, I would be very honest here. I'm not the kind of person to geek out a lot over social media platforms. I don't make social media creation. I see it less as a science, more as an art. I would love to, you know, explore, try new things. Kuch kar liya, nahi chala, theek hai, we'll try something else. So yes, like, of course, there are a lot of technical things that I have to keep in mind, but I also am a little open-ended that way. You know, if you go back and, you know, the first 50,000 followers I got on Instagram, I never even used one hashtag, never used hashtag as a strategy. I couldn't figure out, you know, I was a very YouTube person. Instagram was not my cup of tea. 50,000, I did it mainly because, you know, it's really about figuring out, you know, creating the right type of content. I feel like people do come to you. You know, it's also easy for me to say this because I started when the competition wasn't this much and, you know, things were relatively easier. But from a technical perspective, the way I look at this is I have three, four content buckets broadly. And, you know, while I have hashtags that are general. So these are like my industry specific hashtags or whatever. I also have post specific hashtags. So if like a particular post is about just let's say side hustling or freelancing, then I have certain hashtags that go there. And if a post is about, you know, my life in general, so then out of the, you're allowed to use 30 hashtags. So of that, 10 are variable for me, 20 are constant. So at least I get authority in those 20 and 10 can keep, you know, moving here and there. So that's usually the, from a technical perspective, but I really don't think social media is a science. I see it more as an art.
Yeah. I mean, sometimes I go into a rabbit hole of reading too much into this.
Yeah, exactly.
Algorithm, hashtag and all of those things work. And sometimes I just feel that, should I really create something that, you know, I'm just passionate about or I really want to talk about. And exactly. Maybe that will connect more with people. So
exactly. So I'm like super open about, if I see like, you know, on my Instagram, I definitely see that reels are a thing today. And everyone's just making, you know, dancing reels and you know, super energetic reels. I don't know, like, do I want to do it? If I feel excited about a trend that comes in and it aligns with my interest, I'm really happy about it. But if there's a trend that doesn't really align with me, it's okay. I feel like, you know, slow growth is what I've had over the last couple of years. I've been doing this for 4 years and I still don't have like a million, you know, subscribers or followers to show for it. But I feel like the small community that I have is so carefully built and has grown so slowly that they connect with me at a completely different level. So today I launch whatever they buy from me. It's easy for me to, you know, connect with them. I feel like virality wala community, when you create, the connection is lost somewhere. So for me, that connection, like I told you, I wasn't looking at myself as a YouTuber so much as a business person. So for me, connection was more important, which is why I started looking at social media, not technically so much as, you know, getting the right people in.
Yeah, and I think virality is very cheap and goes also very cheaply and very
easy. Exactly.
48 hours, 72 hours and all of that trend and virality is gone. And that audience also isn't very engaged and, you know, strongly connected rather than someone who has built it for years, connected with them, engaged with them for years.
Absolutely.
So that's the difference between virality. I have one philosophical question to ask you. And then some lighthearted questions, and then we'll wrap up. The philosophical question, and I don't want to put too much burden on the question here, but, you know, I tend to ask people as to what is something that's, you know, how do they keep themselves motivated to keep doing what they are doing every day? And I have found some brilliant answers with respect to everybody whenever I ask them on this show. And you're going to be the 17th person who's going to answer that. So I really want to know from you, what is something that, you know, excites you in the morning to, you know, about the Monday mornings or Sunday mornings as to, you know, oh, wow, this is something that I'm going to do today. How is it? Is it about the team building process? Is it about the impact that you're creating for people or what it is that, you know, keeps you doing what you're doing?
Right. So for me, this is a question that I ask, you know, even my students in the academy, you know, you need to know your why. What's your why? What's driving you? Because if you don't know your why, it's very easy to stop. Because the point is, you know, there's this theory, right? Like there's this optimism of ignorance when you begin something. You know, you're like, I'm going to do this. You don't realize the kind of work that will be required, which is why a lot of people take the first step and then comes in, you know, the course of knowledge is when you realize there's so much to do and that's where most people stop. And to get through that phase and to reach the third phase, which is the phase of growth, I feel like it's really important for you to know your why. If your why is very strong, you're able to navigate through the second phase very easily. So my why is very simple. You know, I honestly truly believe that, you know, that India is ready for the new work culture, right? Like the idea that, you know, the whole, so I've seen the rich in the world, right? The people who, all of the billionaires and the multimillionaires that we have in India, I've seen them and I've seen them grow massive companies. I think India is truly ready to have one person unicorns, right? And I want to be the person to bring more of those in India. So, you know, yes, I want to be a one person unicorn myself, but I also want to be the person building more one person unicorns in India. I really want to create that in India. I want, you know, passion economy, creator economy to grow, freelancing economy to grow as much as possible in India, because our education system truly is broken. You know, we're never exposed to these ideas. We're never told that there is something that lies, you know, beyond a job or beyond, you know, the traditional routes. And while I have nothing against a job, I loved my job, absolutely loved it. But this passion that I have today, I just never had for my job. You know, even though I loved it, I just never had it. So that's my why. I want India to have solopreneurs. I want to have more. This, that's what my t-shirt says. We just I want to create as many solopreneurs as possible in this country.
Got it. And I think that's a brilliant answer to that question. And, you know, something that, you know, we at Pepper also are really passionate about is that, you know, how we can build this whole culture and the community of, you know, freelancers, trying to make them understand that, you know, after your college, maybe you don't have to go for a job or placement and all of those things. And maybe you just can start something of your own, or maybe freelance or whatever you are passionate about. That's it. We are on plus one with you on this. So, like, totally resonate with what you believe in and what you're trying to achieve. Very some random questions I wanted to ask you, which is something as simple as who are like your favorite creators on the internet, on YouTube or Instagram, Twitter, wherever, who are some of the famous, like, favorite creators for you?
I tend to watch a lot of vlogs. I really enjoy watching vlogs, you know, just people casually living their lives on camera. Love that. So I think, the whole, you know, Flying Beast family, I think they're the cutest. So they're amazing. I really like their content. I think they're just amazing people. I also, really enjoy, you know, recently I've really been enjoying Ankur Variku's content, you know, because, honestly, he has been a traditional entrepreneur, you know, who's done things traditionally, and then to break off from that and doing what he does today, it's so inspiring to look at that. So I think Ankur Variku is definitely one of my recent favorites. And, you know, internationally, I've always watched Tim Ferriss's, like, I've always listened to his podcast. So, and 4-Hour Workweek is what really got me into this. I feel like that's one book that has changed my life. And I give 90% of credit to everything that I've done to that book. So, yeah, these are some of my absolute favorite creators.
Got it. What is one tip that you want to give to people who want to build on Instagram, which is not Reels? Any other tip that you would suggest people apart from Reels to grow on Instagram?
To grow on Instagram, I think, you know, underestimated stories. I feel like stories are massive on Instagram, you know, and they are just such a powerful tool. They're so raw, so authentic. Like, you know, I may not, like, all of my favorite creators, I may not, you know, engage with their post wala content or their reels, but if they show up on stories and they show me their life, they show me how they live, they show me their thoughts and ideas in the most raw form possible. I feel, for me personally, my favorite Instagram feature is stories, and the fact that the fact that we have DMs there where you actually can communicate with people. Yeah. Feel like, use stories, get people to your DMs. Even if you have 500 people in your community on Instagram today, if you get them, give them the right stories, get them to your DMs, you can sell them. You can sell your freelance services, you can sell your products, you can sell your services, you can sell whatever you want. You just need to use the combination of stories and DMs very well.
Got it. One last question, and this is related to YouTube. What are, like, some big no-nos that people should, like, avoid while they are, you know, starting to YouTube? Because I feel a lot of people focus on being that perfectionist, and, you know, they want to create, like, one perfect video. But what are some other, you know, things that they should avoid while they're starting up on YouTube?
Yeah, I think one thing that you mentioned is very important, you know, just starting is so important, you know, waiting to get the right camera, waiting to have the right idea, waiting to have the right channel banner, all of that's not needed, like really not needed. The way I tell this to people is the best time to start a YouTube channel was yesterday, the next best is today. So do it, like, you know, don't wait another day, start it, start today if you want to start. Because I regret the fact, you regret it as well, you know, the fact that we didn't start back then. So I don't want others to feel that way. So I'm like, just start with whatever you have. And I think another important thing that a lot of, you know, YouTubers do when they start out on the journey, and I wouldn't say this is, you know, the first couple of months, maybe 6 months down the lane in their YouTube journey, they would get a lot of brand collaboration opportunities, right? Because there's a lot of brand money that flows on YouTube. I tell all of the students in my academy and everyone I meet is like, please be very careful of the kind of brands you work with, because brands are going to come and go, you know, quick money is not why you should come on YouTube. You build the right community, you build the right kind of relationships with your audience, their monetization opportunities will come to you. Like, you know, you wouldn't even have to do anything, they'll come to you. But, you know, just partnering with any brand that comes your way, feel like is not is definitely something that, you know, YouTubers should be wary about, because there are all kinds of brands that would just send you like a free thing, or that would, you know, just creating your whole channel's presence based off of branded content, I feel like is not the right route to take, because can really impact you in the long run. And I think the last tip that I do have for YouTubers is to just, like, you know, relax a little bit. It's, you know, people take their jobs too seriously, especially YouTubers take their job too seriously. They want to make sure that every video should have a lot of new information in it, or every video should have, you know, like some value that they're giving. It could be educational value, entertainment value. It needs to have something. And only then should that video go out. And this advice is, of course, to people, but more to me as well. I feel like I need to just like relax a little bit, right? Yesterday I just created, because now I don't even have my videographer because of the lockdown. She can't come home. And I was like, I was just feeling lost. How do I create content without my videographer? And I was like, how did I do it for the first 2 years? I did not have a videographer. Just picked up a camera, shot something, and I'm going to upload it today. So, you know, and it was such a liberating feeling. The fact that, you know, it's at the end of the day, it's just video. People are happy to watch whatever you create. You know, it could be, if people can sit and watch 10-hour long videos of somebody just cutting through something, people can watch anything on YouTube. So don't take your content too seriously. Have fun. At the end of the day, content, I feel like a lot of us, you know, I don't think anybody in the world today is a YouTuber because their parents, you know, forced them to be a YouTuber. That it's not engineering or medicine. So all the pressure that YouTubers feel, I feel like, is a lot to do with the fact that we put that pressure on ourselves. So if we can just relax a little bit, enjoy the process, take it light, I feel like that helps a lot.
Wow, I think that's a brilliant also motivation for people to, you know, just go ahead and start YouTubing also, because people take it up very like seriously. Oh, I have to reach like 1 million subscribers in 1 year. I have to do this, I have to do that. I need to have brand collabs and all of those things. I think sometimes it's much, much fun and easier to, you know, reach that goal when you enjoy the whole process of content creation altogether.
And honestly, I'm telling you, the kind of videos that would get you the subscribers on YouTube, you won't be able to plan it. Virality, you cannot plan. The two videos that have got me the maximum number of followers and views and all of that, I was almost about to not publish them, because I was like, I'm not happy with this. I don't think this is right for me. But I just like published it. And, you know, that video has spelling mistakes. That video has, you know, all kinds of errors in it. But that's what got me a lot of my subscribers and, you know, my whole community that I have today. So I feel like you really can't, you know, you may plan, but at the end of the day, something random somewhere will click. And, you know, so yeah. What's more important is just consistency. Just show up every day with whatever you can create.
Saroni, thank you so much for sharing all these tips. You know, I'm happy that, you know, that Instagram glitch occurred and, you know, we could do this conversation in a more structured format on Pepper Spotlight instead of just that IG live. But thank you so much for sharing all these insights with us, telling us about your journey and every other tips and tricks that you have shared for all our listeners and viewers of this show.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me. It's always amazing having these kind of conversations with people who more or less have the same vision, right? Like we do with Pepper and Hustle Post. I feel like we're mostly talking about the same thing all the time. So having these conversations.
Super. I think this has been like a great conversation altogether. And people who are watching this or listening this, we're going to mention the link to your YouTube channel also in the description of this episode. So people can just go ahead and check that out. But thank you so much once again. Yeah, every YouTuber, I think that's like the
that's just a
oh,
very
that's like
cute. That's just a YouTuber thing. You give me your plug, I'll say like, share, subscribe.
Super. Everyone, please like, share, and subscribe to Saloni's channel. The link to the channel is in the description of this episode. But thank you so much once again, Saloni, for giving us your
thank
time.
You. Thank you so much. Thank you.
I hope you enjoyed this episode. And what we're going to do is just mention some links in the description of this episode. Every week, we send out a newsletter to our creator community, which a lot of people enjoy. So if you are interested into learning about freelancing or about what's really happening in the content ecosystem or about the creator economy, just check the link in the description of this episode and you can subscribe from there. Apart from that, if you have any suggestions or any recommendations for us, please, please feel free to DM us directly on Instagram, Twitter, LinkedIn, wherever you are connected with us. It's @pepper_content. The link to our social media accounts is also in the description of this episode. But more importantly, please take care, stay safe, and stay indoors.